though we shouldn't doubt. And there is a light, don't let it go out. And this is the song, song for someone. This is a song for someone. It let me into a conversation, a conversation only we could make. You're breaking into my imagination. Whatever's in there, it's yours to take. I was told I feel nothing the first time. You were slow to hear, but this could be the night. If there is a light, you can always see. And there is a world we can always be. If there is a dark within and without, and there is a light, don't let it go out. And this is so.
We'll get started here in a minute. Sorry about doing it earlier today, but it's good to see some people get the message. But we are actually cooking hamburgers and hot dogs for the teachers at Johnson Elementary today. So I got to get ready for that. So I'm doing the devotional a little early. Good morning, Sam. Good morning, Tracy. Good morning to the others who are watching but not posted anything. Post something so I know you're watching, know who you are. We'll be looking at Philippians chapter 2. First two verses, really, setting the stage for the first 11 verses. But Philippians chapter 2. Of course, make sure you share this, and even after it's done, it'll be on our Facebook page. And I'm also downloading the video and putting it on YouTube. So, you know, if you like it, you know, you can share it to anyone later. They don't have to necessarily watch it live. Good morning, Tim. How are you? Watching the clock, waiting for it to hit 9. And we'll get started.
Every breaking wave on the shore, there's the next one, there'll be one more. And every gambler knows.
All right, well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to 15W, which means 15 minutes in the Word. And this is part 5 of our devotionals going through Philippians. And Paul's letter to the Philippian church, and I hope you've enjoyed it so far, and I appreciate the positive comments I have received from some of you, but anyway, and again, I apologize for doing it an hour early. The goal is, or the plan is, at 10 o'clock on Tuesdays and Thursdays, but if you weren't here earlier, our church is cooking hamburgers and hot dogs for the teachers at Johnson Elementary School. They are in service this week. And so we have to have the hamburgers ready by 11. So I have a couple errands to run after this to get ready for that. But it'll be a fun day. It's nice and cool outside, not too hot. So it should be a good day. And it's always fun to meet with the teachers and talk with them and encourage them as they start school, especially this year with the weird school situation we have. But anyway. So Philippians chapter 2 is where we're going to be this morning. And but let me just say some background before we look, and we'll look at the first two verses today. This is kind of a two-part thing. We'll finish. I really want to look at Philippians chapter 2, the first 11 verses, because they fit together, but we'll divide it in half as far as what we're going to talk about, the first two verses today, and then Thursday we'll look at the rest of the verses of chapter 2, verses 1 through 11 anyway. So by way of review, remember that the church in the city of Philippi was founded by Paul on his second missionary journey. And this really we think probably became Paul's favorite church. He loved all of his churches, but he was really close to this church, made up mainly of Gentile believers. He was close to them, and this letter that he writes to them is very personal, which is why we think that he was really, really close to this church, and it very well could have been his favorite church of all the churches that he started. Paul was in prison, remember, when he wrote this. This was his first imprisonment, so he knew that he was going to be released. Eventually, he's arrested again, and eventually he's executed by Emperor Nero, beheaded, actually. But even writing from a prison cell tied to special unit guards, Paul's theme in this letter is joy. Rejoice again. I rejoice in the Lord always, and I say it again, rejoice. Philippians 4:4, kind of the theme verse of the entire letter. But while this was his favorite church, it was by no means a perfect church. For starters, and we saw this in chapter 1, there were some people in the church who were bad-mouthing Paul and talking behind his back. And so he had to deal with that a little bit. No one was really questioning his apostleship like other letters that he wrote, but yet there was still some grumblers and complainers, as there always is in churches. There was also divisions in the church, and this is really what Paul's getting at in chapter 2, that the church was not united like they should be. In fact, the divisions in this church were so sharp that in chapter 4, verse 2, Paul calls two women out on the carpet and says to them, "I plead with Euodia and I plead with Cynthia to agree with each other in the Lord." Now, can you imagine that? That two people in the church were so much at odds with each other that the pastor or the apostle calls them out publicly and tells them they better start getting along. In chapter 1, Paul wanted to relieve any anxiety the people in the church may have had because of his imprisonment, and so he relieves that. But then in chapter 2, Paul addresses the problems in the church, and the first problem is a lack of unity, and that's what I want to look at today and Thursday, this lack of unity in the church. Now, I believe in the local church. I have been a pastor for over 30 years. I've been working in the local church for probably closer to 40 years, and I'm only 54 years old, and so I believe in the local church. In fact, I believe that the local church is the hope of the world. Now, I know some people say, well, Jesus is the hope of the world, and that's correct, but the reason I say that the local church is the hope of the world is because it's the local church that stewards the message of Jesus, and that's responsible for the message of the gospel and spreading it. And so, in essence, the church is the hope of the world because it stewards that message of the gospel. It's not the government. The government obviously is not the hope of the world. It's not education. It's not social programs. And it's not even that one day we would have world peace. The hope of the world is the church because it stewards the message of Jesus Christ. But if the local church is the hope of the world, why does it seem that the church has lost its influence and relevance in the world today? I mean, I have unfortunately told people that it seems like the only people in the United States listening to evangelicals are other evangelicals. But the world as a whole doesn't have the same respect that it once did, or at least, and even in our own society, the church doesn't hold that place of authority that it once did. And it's our fault. It's not really the world's fault. Popular evangelist and pastor D.L. Moody, who lived a long time ago in the United States, but D.L. Moody used to use this illustration, and I think it's so relevant. He would say, "The place of a ship is in the sea, but God help the ship whose sea gets into it." And he would apply that to the church and say, likewise, the place of the church or the place for the church is in the world, but God help that church who lets the world get into it. And I think that that's really what has happened. And the church has lost its relevance because we've become more concerned about popularity. We have become more concerned about being relevant to the culture. We have been more concerned about gaining political power than we have in just stewarding the message of Jesus that God has given us. And so when the church is doing what it's supposed to be doing, it is the single most powerful and influential organism in the world. However, the reverse of that is true. A dysfunctional church can be the most harmful organization in the world. There are therapy groups and small groups that meet around the fact that people have been abused by the church. And so when the church is on mission, there's nothing like it. Jesus said the gates of hell cannot stop it. But when the church has lost its focus and becomes divided and dysfunctional, then there's really nothing that can be done. So what's the difference? What's the difference between a purposeful church and a not purposeful church? Well, it's really the people who make up the church. And so in the first 11 verses of chapter 2, Paul lays out two keys to authentic Christianity. And I think applying these two keys to our lives and to the lives of our churches will open up the door to fulfill our potential as a church. And those two keys are unity and humility. Unity and humility. And so today, with the time we have left, I want to mention unity. And then Thursday, we'll come back and talk about humility. And so look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Paul writes, "If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose." So four times in verse 1, Paul uses that little phrase, "if any," if any. And the idea is not doubt. He's not doubting, but the idea is really sense, S-I-N-C-E. And so it should be translated that way. So let's look at verse 1 again. And instead of saying, "if any," let's use the word "since," and we get what Paul is saying. Paul is saying, since you have encouragement from being united with Christ, since you have comfort from his love, since you have fellowship with the Spirit, since you have tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, by being united. And so the church is to display unity because in Christ we have shared in the experience of five things, he says. He says we've shared in the experience of encouragement, of comfort, of fellowship, of tenderness, and of compassion. And so based on our shared experience in Christ, and because we have received such wonderful gifts from him, Paul says we should be like-minded. We should be one. In what ways are we to be like-minded? Well, Paul continues in verse 2 and says that we should have having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. You see, folks, we're to love each other the way Christ loved us. That means that we're to love each other unconditionally, sacrificially, and persistently. Be like-minded. Being one in spirit, Paul says. The phrase "one in spirit" is one word in the Greek and literally means be together in soul. Listen to me, folks. In Christ and because of Christ, we, the body of Christ, we, his church, are to treat one another as if we are soul mates. Because in essence, that's what we are. One in spirit. The word "purpose" that Paul uses at the end of chapter 2 is the same word that he translates that's translated "like-minded" at the beginning of verse 1. And so he basically says it twice. Be purposeful. Be like-minded. One in spirit. One in purpose. Why? Because we have shared encouragement, comfort, fellowship, tenderness, and compassion in Christ Jesus. See, there's nothing stronger than the local church when the people of the church are united and share that oneness. You see, folks, in these verses, Paul is emphatically saying that to the believers in Philippi, and he is emphatically saying to us, be united. Be united. Since you are one in Christ, in other words, be one with each other. What key would unity unlock? Remember, there's two keys here to authentic Christianity and authentic churches, unity and humility. We'll talk about humility Thursday, but what key does unity unlock? Unity will unlock the door to our potential as a church and as individuals. unity would be our testimony to the world that we are indeed Christians. Jesus prayed, "By this all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another." Together, there is nothing that we cannot do. There is no challenge we cannot face, and there is no obstacle we cannot overcome. Right now in our world, churches, and not just individual churches, but the body of Christ as a whole is divided. And as a result, we have zero influence in our culture. But if we would come together, we could change the world. A united church is a powerful church. A united church shows the world what it means to be an authentic Christian. We are one. How many of us have heard people say they left the church because the people in the church just could never get along and they got tired of the argument? What an indictment. You see, folks, unity doesn't mean uniformity, but it does mean that we work together and we love one another and we stay united in purpose because of Christ and for the glory of God. Look at those verses again. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Two keys to authentic Christianity. One is unity. The second is humility. We'll talk about humility Thursday. Have a good day.